hundreds of years before the dawn of history, lived a strange race of people, the Druids. No one knows who they were or what they were doing, but their legacy remains, hewn into the living rock of Stonehenge.
The banshees live and they do live well. Stonehenge.
Well, a man for man and the children dance to the pipes of Pan.
Absolute fucking classic there.
Absolute classic. I'd like to take attention to the fact that that would not be possible without the hard work of Ian Faith, who goes out to find mandolin strings in Atlanta.
Well, it was Austin, actually.
Austin? Sorry.
Yeah, I believe, though, that, like, finding mandolin strings in Austin would probably not be hard at all.
Well, like, no, I mean, that goes for a lot of the work that Ian does.
Yeah, at 6:30 on a Friday, that would be pretty easy.
Yeah, exactly.
Stonehenge. Stonehenge is easily the best song, in my opinion.
I don't know. It's really hard to say. Like, they're all so good, but, like,
I've got a penchant for Heavy Duty.
Oh, yeah.
Heavy Duty's sick.
I don't know. I really like Gimme Some Money.
Gimme Some Money's really fucking good.
Gimme Some Money.
We'll talk about the music more and we'll listen to it more a little bit later on, and that's why we're not on Spotify probably.
I think we have to do an edit for Spotify.
That's not a bad idea. We'll talk about that later. So Jake, do you want to recap our last episode a little bit? Us up.
So we went through a little bit about the production of the film. We talked about Rob Reiner's career and how he hooked up with the other fabulous people in this movie, and sort of the genesis of the idea for Spinal Tap itself and how it went through a couple different stages from, like, being a skit to them making, like, a sort of demo short film for the movie. And then
it's just pretty fucking funny.
Yeah, it is pretty funny.
Both the skit and the movie are the short film, and the short film is, like, interesting too.
I don't know, the one thing I will say with the short film is because, like, I know how much of the film that they improvised, it's like it kind of bothers me to know which parts weren't improvised because they were already done in the short film.
Yeah.
I find that super interesting. Like, it does kind of ruin the magic in a little bit of the way. In a little bit of a way, but because they are improvising in the sense that they had said that they had really hashed out the, like, characters.
So,
like,
then again, it's interesting that, like, it's not possible to tell necessarily what was improvised and what wasn't, unless you
my point there was that they aren't necessarily not improvising.
Right.
It's just that they're saying the same information again.
Right.
If
but
you
I,
know
mean,
what I mean,
yeah.
Because the scenes aren't exactly the same. The same information is presented because they know that Spinal Tap. They know, because remember they said that they thought of all the background and shit. So they thought of, like, the originals.
The scene that I'm thinking of is the scene with the this scene was actually completely different in the film versus in the short thing, which was about the cover.
Yeah, the smell the glove.
Yeah, I always thought that, like, when they were saying the cover, that was the first time the actor was hearing what was on the cover.
Right, okay.
Which I thought was really funny, but apparently that's not how it happened.
Right.
Because he already knew it was on the cover because he had done it in the...
Yeah.
But I guess that's not what it was. He knew what it was on the cover already.
I mean, I never knew until going through the podcast outline that most of the movie was improvised. So, I mean, even scripted, I thought everything was amazing.
I mean,
right?
Yeah, but, it's definitely...
But, So, I mean, to me, finding out that some stuff is not improvised, I'm still just impressed to find out that it... What amount of it had been.
It's still improvised in the sense that there was never a script.
Yeah, definitely.
But so, the like, information existed.
I'm wondering, something like the song All the Way Home. Like, were they coming up with that song on the spot?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they improvised that scene. I remember reading somewhere that they improvised that scene.
That's a different one, but that's also
that's the same one.
No, that's the Heartbreak Cartel scene where they're at Elsa's grave.
Oh,
yeah,
right.
Yeah. The All the Way Home is how does it go? Well, if she's not on the 519, I'm gonna
know what sorrow means, and I'm gonna cry
all the way home.
All the way home.
Do you remember the first song that you guys ever wrote together?
All the Way Home, probably.
Yeah. All the Way Home?
Yeah.
Can you remember a little bit of it? I'd love to hear.
Christ. Some black coffee, maybe.
How's it going? I'm beside the railroad track. And I'm waiting for that train to bring you back. Bring me back. Around the line. If she's not on the 519, then I'm gonna know what sorrow means, and I'm gonna cry all the way home, all the way home, all the way home, all the way home.
Cry all the way home.
Fairly simple.
It was
about six words in the whole song.
That was super impressive that they improvised that.
But I wonder about the Heartbreak Hotel scene as well, if they improvised that too.
Well, I know that specifically they knew that they were going to do Heartbreak Hotel.
Right.
Because that was the only Elvis song that they got the rights to.
Right. But I wonder if they knew how they were going to do it.
Well, no, I assume they just kind of like... Because the whole idea is that it's bad. Yeah, like, their rendition of Heartbreak Hotel is terrible.
That's right. It's a beautiful harmonization.
Like, I don't know. That's it. That's another thing that I thought was, like, super on the nose about the film when they're talking about, like, you know, harmonies. Or like, when they're just talking about, like, people coming up with things like that. Like, I don't know. Like, it's interesting that we're doing this movie, obviously, because we've been in a band, and we kind of are in a band right now, you know, despite Corona.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
Corona keeping us apart here, but it's just like every time, like, I've ever tried to do that exact same thing, like just come up with harmonies like on the spot, that exact same thing always happens.
Yes, like, it's very much totally true. No, I'm doing the false. The fifth.
That's
why it's so on the nose.
I know exactly. It's just like it's so perfect because it's like. Like, so many of these things I've, like, actually seen, and it's, like, so true.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and we should, like, I don't think we mentioned it last time, but we'll get into it a bit more, but they played all the instruments in the movie and, like, in the soundtrack. Like, it's these guys in the band plus the other guys.
Yeah, like, it wasn't live on set, screen. But it was, like,
Christopher Guest wrote most of the music, right? Yeah.
Yeah, but like they are lip syncing in the shot.
Right, fair enough.
Yeah.
Just because, obviously.
We can jump right into the production now. So from where we were, just a little bit of backup. The people who were already cast from the demo that we were talking about were Tony Hendra, who played Ian Faith. Rick Parnell played Mick Shrimpton, the drummer, and Rick Parnell had played in a band called Atomic Rooster, you may or may not know is the band that started Carl Palmer's career.
I do, in fact, know of Carl Palmer and his time at Atomic Rooster.
Carl Palmer of Emerson, Lake
and Palmer. Carl Palmer of Emerson, Lake and Palmer, yes.
Yeah, so he just dipped out to ELP, and then they called up Rick Parnell to replace him.
Right.
I don't know if he was a direct replacement, because he played it in the band for like 2 months shortly after Carl Palmer left, and then he left the band, and then he went back to the band.
Mm. Oh, okay.
A few months later and played with them for a couple of years. Mm. Anyway, so it's 1982-ish. and they start casting a lot of the backups, who, Jake, you were going to mention in part one, but I stopped you. So do you want to go ahead now?
Yeah, like, I just find it really funny, like, all the people that were sort of in the background of the movie.
Mm.
Like, I mean, we previously mentioned Fred Willard in, like, an early tiny part.
Yeah.
And then also, like, the mimes. Like
the mime waiters.
That's a great scene,
yeah.
too.
Yeah, so the two mimes are actually Billy Crystal and Dana Carvey.
Right, so which one's berating the other one?
Oh, Billy Crystal is the one doing the berating.
Right.
He's like, you can tell, like, if you hear the voice, you're like, oh my god, that's Billy Crystal.
That's
like,
pretty funny.
Yeah. Wait a second, that's Mike Wazowski.
Exactly.
I did the flapping. Don't give me talk back. Just go.
Yeah, yeah.
Just go. Yeah.
And then also, like, a really weird small part was Angelica Houston.
Oh yeah, I totally forgot about that.
Because she looks completely different than she normally does, and she's the artist who makes the Stonehenge monument.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I just thought was really funny because it's like a really tiny part. I don't know. Are there any that I'm missing?
Well, there's also, so you have Paul Schaefer.
Right.
He plays Artie Fufkin.
Artie Fufkin, yes.
The kick my ass guy.
Literally. I'm begging you. I'm not asking. I'm telling.
Kick my ass.
Kick my ass.
I thought we
Come
had
on.
A relationship here.
I'm not doing anything.
We had a relationship here. I don't know what happened.
Business is terrible, Artie. What can I tell you? This is the truth.
I know business is terrible, but what happens with a record store, with a promotion, and nobody shows up?
This isn't a personal thing, Artie. Nobody's coming in the store.
Forget personal thing. We had a relationship here. Forget about personal. What about a relationship? Dude, will you do something for me?
What?
Do me a favor. Just kick my ass, okay? Kick this ass for a man, that's all. Kick my ass. Enjoy. Come on. I'm not asking, I'm telling with this. Kick my ass.
So then also, I forgot to mention this in the last episode, but in the demo, the guy who plays Viv Savage is notably different.
Yes.
And he's more of a presence in the demo than he is in the movie.
Yeah, it's true. Viv Savage, like, he barely gets covered in the movie. I have a feeling that he had more stuff that got cut.
Mm.
Yeah, probably.
Like, which I guess they wisely sort of figured out that, like, you know, the core of the story was, like, Nigel and David.
Yeah.
And,
yeah,
exactly. Like, sort of the relationship between those, so that that was what they focused on.
I am, however, glad that they kept his philosophy on life. Have a good time all of the time.
Yeah. I get a sense that there was a lot of kind of stuff that got cut out, because I know that they did spend a lot of time editing this movie.
Right.
Yeah. McKean said that there was, like, tons of heartbreak in the editing room at all the great scenes they had to cut.
Yeah, I can imagine, because they probably had some really funny jokes.
A lot of it's comedic gold, right? So, I mean, I guess you want to have it be concise, but it's not like the movie ran too long anyway. It's like under an hour and a half, right?
No, exactly. But I'm saying, like, it's a good thing it didn't, and that's probably because they cut out so much shit, right?
Right.
Yeah, well, as, like, they shot over 100 hours of footage.
Right. That's a lot.
Oh, wow. I really want to see some of that now.
I know. I don't know.
Now I
want to
know
what
I'm missing is the thing, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of deleted scenes floating around on YouTube and, like, extended scenes. So, like, I think a lot of it is, like, the scenes that you see went on for, like, 20 minutes each one.
Oh, okay.
And then they just, like, cut them into the best of the...
So there were probably just a couple jokes that didn't make it, but all the scenes were kind of the same?
Well, I'm not necessarily. Like, I'm sure there were other scenes as well, but that's also probably a lot of that 100 hours probably comes at least from that.
Hmm.
But, yeah. But Viv Savage, so I was just trying to figure out who the guy who played it was. So he's credited in the film as being played by David Kaff. So I looked up David Kaff. David Kaff, Wikipedia page, redirects to a page for a band called Rare Bird.
Okay.
Bird. Go on.
No, I was just going to say, so are we saying he's not an actor?
No, well, it doesn't seem like he's an actor. There's nothing to do with acting. His name redirects to this band.
Mm-hmm.
So I looked at the band members. There's no David Kaff, but there is a David Caffinetti.
Oh.
So he has a Wikipedia page, so I clicked on it. but it also redirects to Rare Bird. So it turns out that David Caffinetti is a name for a guy who was born David Franklin Ewer.
Okay, so it's not, is it the same guy?
Yeah, it is the same guy. Okay. Anyway, he's just like an actual organ player for this band, Rare Bird.
Right.
Who had a number one hit in Italy and France in 1969.
So I guess he was just some guy they knew, and...
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, maybe that's another reason he didn't get a lot of, like, screen time. It's just because, like...
Not as good.
Well, yeah, no, but also, like, you know, a lot of the jokes were probably improvised between, like, you know, the main guys.
Mm.
And, you know, he probably just... Because he wasn't coming up with any material for his character, like, he didn't have, like, you know,
yeah,
anything to, well, say, yeah, really.
Him and Rick Parnell were both, like, musicians, right? So
yeah, exactly.
They weren't comedic actors, so they held their own a little bit, but they weren't really there to be that,
yeah,
funny.
Exactly.
but they were pretty funny.
Yeah,
they were good.
Definitely, yeah.
They were good.
But I mean, obviously, once again, they didn't have that much screen time.
No, and I do feel like Rick Parnell and David Caff really brought the drugs to the sex, drugs, and rock,
oh,
and
yeah,
roll of Spinal Tap.
Yeah, that's true.
That was their whole role. That's true.
Just act fucked up.
Oh, and yeah, there's also the bit where he's like, "Can you do like a part with the bass line on Big Bottom?" Like Nigel does, and he's like, "I've,
yeah,
got two hands.
I've got two hands.
Of course,
I can do that.
I've got two hands, don't I?"
Yeah.
I don't even think he's being sarcastic. He's just like, "Yeah, I can do that. I got two hands."
So yeah, as I said, 100 hours of footage shot by a guy named Peter Smokler. I believe that's how you pronounce it.
Smokler or Smokler? I don't know. I was unable to determine this.
It's a difficult one. We thought we weren't going to have to do a pronunciation guide for this one.
Well, I didn't do one because I couldn't figure out how it was pronounced. I didn't have the resources,
yeah,
to do that.
So if you know, email,
yes,
crankitcommentaries@gmail.com. Smokler, Smokler, let us know. Yeah, so it took 3 editors plus Rob Reiner over a year to edit the film.
Wow.
Which is incredible.
I feel like... Had they had access to, like, modern digital editing, it probably would have even taken longer, because they probably would have, like, you know, done more, like, cutting in and out.
Mm.
I don't know. I always assume it would be shorter digitally. Just because,
well, no,
of, like,
it would be in
physical...
terms of, like, the actual doing of the task would be easier. But I'm saying, like, because it's easier,
they would spend more time
doing it.
I don't know if they'd spend a year on it, though. I don't think you spend a year and plus on editing if you don't have to.
Yeah, maybe.
Although, that being said, how's our film going?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so I was thinking we could go through some of the memorable scenes, because you can't really talk about this movie without talking about, like, it goes up to 11 and all that, so...
Yeah, I mean, that whole scene with the guitar collection was one of my favorites.
Is excellent.
It's just like, being a guitar player myself, like, I definitely identify a little bit with what Nigel's like on about.
That's,
you know,
hilarious. So, like, the don't even breathe on it.
Don't look at it either.
You've had enough of that one.
Yeah, that scene just keeps giving and giving and giving.
Well, one of my favorite bits is, like, he's talking about, like, how precious all the guitars are and, like, how he's supposed to handle them carefully. And then he's just, like, has a lit cigarette that is just, like, ashes are falling off of it onto all the guitars.
Yeah, the one with the sustain when he picks it up.
Yeah, he's like,
I don't hear anything. Yeah, but you would if it was plugged in.
You would if it were playing, you know.
If it were playing, I could just go.
You gotta have a bite. You still be hearing that one.
I especially love the radio frequency guitar that is portable and doesn't need a.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, that comes up later at the Air Force Base.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
why
yeah,
I'm
yeah,
saying it's just.
Well, I like that they have that in there. It's
and
sort
it comes
of a,
out at the end too. Comes up at the
yeah,
end
good
too.
Continuity.
Yeah,
yeah.
In,
yeah.
When they're playing in Japan, he's trying to solo.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. little bit of a Chekhov's gun there.
That's also the scene where he's wearing the shirt with like the green.
This is actually
although
that was
exact...
over the credits though, wasn't it?
Yeah, but it's like, still it's the same scene.
It was the same,
the same bit.
It was shot at the same time, I assume.
Yeah. This is my exact in the structure.
But it wouldn't be green. Actually, it would be green, you know, is the thing. Well, if you look at your arms, it's, you know, well, that's just the skin underneath the
it's
blood
just the
is
vein.
Red.
That's why it's blue. It's your blood. It's red. Like,
yeah.
Like, oh, well, maybe it isn't.
Maybe it isn't green. But anyway. Okay. But also, okay.
I feel like that was improvised. Like that.
Yeah, it must have been.
You like this?
It's very nice. It looks like Halloween.
This is my exact inner structure done in a t-shirt. Exactly medically accurate. See?
So in other words, if we were to take all your flesh and blood and every
take
all
them
of,
off.
You'd see exactly,
this is what you'd
it wouldn't
see.
Be green though.
It is green. You know, see how your blood looks blue?
Yeah, well that's just the vein. I mean the color of the vein. I mean the blood is actually red.
Oh, well, maybe it's not green. I don't know. Anyway, this is what we sleep in sometimes.
Yeah.
Did you notice, speaking of Nigel's shirts, did you notice that, okay, so he's got the Gumby t-shirt that he wears, right? And then later on he's wearing a shirt with like a little square shirt pocket, and he's got a statue of Gumby hanging in his pocket.
Yeah, it's weird. I don't know what's up with that.
I don't know what his Gumby his thing.
You can also
Gumby
tell
is.
That their tour budget is not very high because they're wearing the same shirts over and over again.
No, but I feel like that's dates. I feel like the reason for that is not because they don't have money. That's just because I feel like they're all just slobs and they're wearing the same t-shirt over and over again.
I think it's a mix.
Like, but like, I mean, they always talk about getting picked up by limos, which is like, and then they get picked up by a limo in the one scene. And it's like, how do they have money to be spending on all these fucking limos when nobody's coming to their, like, tour, like nobody's coming to their shows?
Oh, so maybe it's like Kiss. It's like a styrofoam cup and then you just rip the entire bottom out.
What?
Well, the analogy is usually that this is the Kiss analogy, is that they went into their finance office guy was like, well, you know, usually your finances is like a styrofoam cup and you fill it up and then you poke a small hole in the bottle and, you know, it slowly comes out and then you keep refilling the cup. But in your guys' case, you ripped the bottom off the cup and no matter how much I pour in, it all goes out immediately.
Right.
Yeah, well, but at the end of the movie, they were in a taxi, right?
That's true.
To their last gigs.
Well, that was because of Janine, though, because she's, like, I guess not as experienced as
she might like to think she is
at being a rock and roll manager.
The combination with it was falling apart anyway, right?
Yeah. But, I mean, also, I think we get a couple indications that, you know, Ian is not a good manager as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's like, he's... oh yeah, the Boston gig is canceled. Don't worry, it's not a big college town.
It's hard. Is he just trying to say, is he just lying to them, though? Cause
yeah, that's the joke. I don't know. It's not clear. It's not clear if he's just thick or if he's, like, lying to them. I guess he's probably doing a bit of both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sugarcoating.
Yeah.
I mean, he knows how to fold ham.
What? Oh, right. Yeah, that's also such a good scene. Yeah, just the bit where Nigel is, like, folding the, where he's backstage, he's trying to make the sandwich.
Yeah.
But the bread's just too small.
Bread's too small.
Yeah, he's,
what do
like,
you do?
He's getting all excited. He's like, don't get it. I just don't want it to affect your performance. It's like, it's not going to affect my performance.
I am a professional. I will rise above.
I will rise above. And he's like, really?
You know, it's a complete catastrophe.
You just keep folding and folding, and the bread keeps breaking. Why would you keep folding?
Look, this miniature bread, it's like, I've been working with this now for about half an hour, and I can't figure out, let's say I want the bite, right? You've got this.
You'd like bigger bread?
Exactly. I don't understand how...
You could fold this, though. I mean,
well, no, then it's half the size.
No, not the bread.
and it'll fold the meat.
Yeah, but then it breaks up, breaks apart like this.
No, you put it on the bread like this, see?
But then if you keep folding it, it keeps breaking. And then everything has to be folded. So it's a complete catastrophe.
No, you're right, Nigel, but calm down.
Calm down. Look, no, it's not a big deal.
I'm sorry.
It's a joke, it's really.
It's just some crack at university, you know?
Yeah, right, it's a joke. It's
all. I don't want it to affect your performance.
It's not going to affect my performance. Don't worry about it, all right? Just hate it. Really, it does disturb me. But I rise above it. I'm a professional, right?
So yeah, should we, that's basically it for the production. You know, that's the, we've talked about it. They improvised most of it. They shot it in a few weeks.
Yeah, it was pretty off the cuff.
Yeah. Should we talk a bit about the music? Because obviously that's like the most important part of the movie.
Yeah, for sure. I'd love to.
So you want to talk about like what's your favorite track, Keaton?
Stonehenge for sure is my favorite track.
Yeah. So that was the one we listened to at the beginning for anybody who doesn't remember, I guess.
Yeah. What about you, Jake? What's your favorite?
I think it's got to be Give Me Some Money.
Yeah. All right. That's not technically a Spinal Tap song.
It's a Townsman song, isn't it?
It's a Townsman, yeah.
Right, yeah. Okay, so my favorite Spinal Tap song, then.
I'll give it to you as the dynamic duo of David and Nigel.
I like... It's a
Tufnell St. Hubbins song.
Yeah, I do like Rock and Roll Creation.
Right, yeah, that's a good one.
That's a great song.
Yeah.
So Rock and Roll Creation.
I just love that one line where he's like, and he knew that it was good. It's just so good. And like the scene that it's like in is also amazing where he's stuck inside the bubble.
Oh, that, yeah. He's stuck inside the, cocoon.
The clamshell kind of cocoon. It's pretty good.
I like how they start just flamethrowing him in there. It's like, that could go so wrong. Like, you're trying to burn him out of it?
Well, I mean, like, I don't get the sense that, like, the road crew for Spinal Tap is, like,
particularly competent. No, not at all.
I mean, given the fact that the prop malfunctioned.
Yeah, in the first place, right?
Like,
and like when Nigel falls over and like they're trying to lift him back up.
Yes. Oh yeah, that's great.
That's excellent.
That one guy in the background.
Mm-hmm.
Felix, what's your favorite song? Did you say?
I didn't. That's a tough one. There's so many that are excellent. It's close. Shout out to Big Bottom for
that's an
unbearably crass.
For sure.
But yeah. I think I'm going to have to go heavy duty.
Heavy duty. So should we listen to that one real quick?
I'm always game. Notes there. What does it mean to bring out the duty in your soul?
I have no
excellent
fucking
question.
And also,
I think it's just stupid. Yeah. I think that's the point.
Well, and it's also just like that meditation stuff can make you go blind. He's always talking about how he's meditating, David St. Hubbins. So it's like,
well, maybe Nigel wrote that song.
I guess.
Well,
so.
But
And maybe and it's maybe, pointed.
Yeah, maybe fucking
yeah, that's true.
David Sahub is just too thick to like realize he's talking about him.
Maybe
although
it's a
Nigel's
shot at
really confused, so
yeah.
Yeah.
And he can get together to make a shot.
It's not Nigel. It's not your job to be as confused
yeah,
as Nigel.
Maybe it's a pointed
just
shot
look
at
him.
Janine. Does love making shots at Janine.
It's not your job to be as confused as Nigel. So yeah, we mentioned they all played their instruments, but we didn't mention their titles, right? It's okay. David Sade Hubbard's on lead guitar. Nigel Tufnell on lead guitar.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Smalls on bass guitar.
Lead bass guitar.
Right. Right.
And so on and so forth. I just thought that you got to know the
two lead guitars, yeah.
Right. Hilarious. I mean, although it's pretty clear who's really the lead guitar player there.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure.
Yeah. So, you want to listen to... would you say your favorite was Gian Keaton?
Well, I said...
Stonehenge, right.
Stonehenge, but okay. We should do Rock and Roll Creation is the one you said.
Yeah, let's do that one.
Utter banger.
So like obviously with like Rick Parnell and what was his name? David Caffinetti was his
yeah.
the name what he called himself, Caffinetti. Obviously they were real musicians, so they added a huge level of musicality that like made it sound really
oh
cool,
yeah, but, definitely.
That being said,
like having a sick drummer on there is like
yeah,
really
it elevates
important.
It.
Yeah. I mean, you know, probably not as sick as Carl Palmer would have been, but like, you know.
But like, regardless, like the guys who aren't musicians like are really good.
Yeah, true. Like,
that,
I mean,
you know?
is that Christopher Guest actually playing all the guitar solos?
It looked like it's everybody. Yeah, it's
okay.
All of them on
That's
the.
Pretty impressive.
I think Christopher Guest. Wrote most of the music and
yeah,
the songs
yeah, yeah.
and lyrics. And,
yeah.
yeah,
but they all perform at yeah their instruments, which is
yeah,
really impressive. And that's
yeah.
it. I find that adds so much to it because it's clear that they like really are having a great time.
Yeah,
doing
definitely
it and, like,
for sure.
Playing
yeah.
musician
yeah, yeah.
and like writing, writing songs, because like their songs are actually pretty, like they're well written. They clearly put a lot of work into making it not just funny but good musically. So it's like that, I think, is what elevates this movie so much in a lot of ways.
Yeah, that's definitely true.
Well, and you
like I mean, I want to draw the comparison to like Walk Hard, because obviously in that movie John C. Reilly plays the main character, right?
Right.
This is, I think, this movie and Walk Hard actually go really well together, because they're kind of like, this movie doesn't have a lot of sex and drugs in it, but that one does.
Right.
And so that's like, true. But also like, so John C. Reilly actually like sings all the songs, and he like knows a lot about music in general.
Yeah, he has a band too.
I think he adds a lot to that movie.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think the music being good is something that's super important in a music movie that is actually like unfortunately overlooked so often.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think the other thing that elevates it too is, well, if you listen to like some of the earlier songs from the Spinal Tap canonical career and when they were at the Tamesmen, etc., right?
Yeah.
And then kind of going through, I mean, you do notice, especially, you know, once, you know, you notice that there's an evolution in the sophistication of their writing and their poetry, and you know, in terms of sexual themes, and you know,
of course,
like, it's on a farm now.
Yeah, they matured. They matured.
They matured. It's on a farm now.
On a farm, yeah.
That's deep. That's poetry.
Yeah, but like, it's also like when they do their earlier stuff, like it's very on the nose, like what they're making fun of, like the give me some money thing. Yeah. It's like, like he's doing such a on the nose like parody of like Mick Jagger with his vocals. Yeah. Like he's just like it's really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so obviously stylistically there's a lot of, you know, parody of metal, parody of, you know, 60s kind of culture music.
Yeah.
And then obviously, I mean, lyrically is excellent.
Yeah.
The parody of all kinds of rock tropes, and honestly a lot of worst parts of rock and roll, right? You know, so you guys let us in with Tonight I'm Gonna Rock It Tonight.
Yeah, that's, yeah, you know.
Which, I mean, if anybody listening noticed, has some fairly disgusting lyrics.
Pretty gross.
You're just 4 feet and you still got your baby teeth.
It's like,
you're too young and I'm too well hung, but tonight I'm gonna rock it tonight.
Yeah.
And obviously we know that in the history of rock there's been a lot of, you know, very
questionable,
if not downright pedophilic behavior.
Yeah.
So.
Oh yeah, it's like, it's so rampant. It's disgusting. Like fucking, just in my research today, like the amount of people I came across, like Jimmy Page and like Nikki Sixx and like
Elvis for
Ted Nugent.
Huh?
Ted Nugent.
Dan Nugent and Jimmy Stewart and or not Jimmy Stewart or
not, you know. Take that back. Don't you dare accuse Jimmy Stewart.
Not Jimmy Stewart. The other one.
Anyway, yeah. It's I mean, pretty bad in the history of rock, but pretty, you know, it's pretty gross, and but it's funny in the way that they do it, which is a hard line to walk.
The gross part is not like, is not necessarily like Spinal Tap's song, but just the fact that like what they're parodying is so on the nose.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's the actual content that they're satirizing that's like gross, not the actual, like what they did is fine and totally, like, it's not. I wouldn't say at least that it's questionable that it's
a fine line to walk in terms of
I think it's pretty clear that, like, you
it's
know,
satirical, yeah.
It's like, you know, you're just 4 feet and you've still got your baby
yeah,
teeth.
I think
not serious.
No, I think probably the more, I don't know if they had a conversation about it, but I think the more out there you make it, the more clear and safe it
But
becomes.
The disturbing part is it's not even like that far out for like a lot of like shit that was going on. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, like little schoolgirl songs and shit. It's like really gross. Really gross shit.
Yeah.
don't know, like, and the like Kiss so song, many bands. Christine 16.
I mean, that's, like, on the low end of, yeah, of gross, right?
Yeah.
But how, like, old was Priscilla, yeah, when yeah, her and Elvis got,
no,
married?
No, but I'm just saying, like, lyrical.
Yeah.
And,
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Well, yeah.
I mean,
even Steven Tyler, like, what? He like, adopted... Not a, he. Well, he didn't adopt her. That's kind of... He, in order, because she was under 16 or something, so in order for her to come on tour with them, he had to, like, make her...
get to be her legal guardian.
Wait,
legal
are you
guardian.
Sure you're not talking about Ted Nugent, or is this just the exact same thing that happened? Yeah,
it's probably
cases?
The exact same thing.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's... I mean, I'm sure it happened all the time, you know?
Yeah.
That's, like, that's how crazy
that's
it
really
is.
Fucked.
And, like, how... Shit's... It's fucked. It's totally fucked. Shit's different for rock stars, apparently, and it's messed up.
Yeah.
Anyway... Hot bangers, though.
Yeah. So, I think we got another segment coming up.
Well, yeah, speaking of all these actual rock stars, I think we got a different segment coming up.
So, what would you say is the logical negation of something that is false?
Hmm. Something that's accurate, maybe?
No, I don't think that's quite it.
No. Correct?
That's closer.
That's closer.
Closer.
So what is the, so something that is, it's not false. It has a quality to it. It is.
Right.
It is,
unfalse.
So it is not false. What do you call that?
Anti-wrong. Oh, I see what you're going for.
I think the word for that is truth.
It wasn't coming to mind.
All right, so I think we've been doing some investigations here.
Yep.
Into,
yeah, as a,
sir,
as a group, we've come together to do some investigations here.
Yeah, so it's my understanding that we all have our own grains of truth.
Yes, well, alleged allegations,
right?
Most, I mean, although some of this we do have pretty hard evidence.
Yes,
in fact. Most of this, I think, is 100% true.
I mean, you can say that the action, the what happened was true, but how it's, you know, whether that's specifically an inspiration of the film.
Right.
Most of the time it's hearsay.
Yeah, but I think what we're basically focusing on is, like, things in the rock and roll world that very closely resemble things in this movie, or things that are that might happen to Spinal Tap.
Yeah,
that's kind of, the second one is more what I was thinking. It's kind of like stuff that could
have happened to Spinal Tap.
It,
yeah,
exactly. Stuff that if you read about it happening to Spinal Tap, you'd be like, "Yep, for sure." but actually, it happened to real people or real bands, and you know, there's the classic stories of Ozzy Osbourne snorting ants. Or Keith Richards snorting his father's ashes because, you know, rock stars like to snort things.
Yeah.
But that's not
sounds
really that
right.
Spinal Tappy.
Yeah, it's true. Because once again, we were saying there's not that much, like, drug stuff in Spinal Tap.
No.
So it's like, while I was looking through this, I found tons of debauchery, but a lot of it was, like, you know, the sex and drugs variety.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of sex and drugs debauchery, but there's not, like, so these are the more, as best we could find them, the more Spinal Tappy things.
Yeah, so, like, these would be kind of, like, you know, malfunctioning stage things, or, like, you know.
There's a few things, but firstly, I just wanted to mention just Steven Tyler. There was a 1997 interview with the rhythm guitarist from Aerosmith, Brad Whitford, talking about Spinal Tap. The first time Steven Tyler saw it, he didn't see any humor in it. When the band's
so maybe that's
first...
what you were thinking of, Jake.
No, I seem to remember Eddie Van Halen saying something
also
about, like, well, I mean, it could just be
it was The Edge. There were two quotes. One,
okay.
The Edge was the one about the crying. But Steven Tyler also didn't see any humor in it.
Too many people felt like there were shots fired, I guess.
Well, no, but I feel like a lot of other people were in on the joke, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like, especially because, like, even on some of the later things, like, they had like, a ton of guests with Spinal Tap that, like, played with them.
Right.
And, yeah. like, I assume they were cool.
You gotta be able to laugh at yourself,
yeah,
right?
I didn't get the vibe that Brad Whitford was implying that he was offended. I got the vibe Brad Whitford was implying that it was, like, so much like him that he didn't get it.
Well, apparently Metallica, like, really enjoyed the movie, and, like, the idea for the Black Album, like, the Metallica album, is based on Smell the Glove.
Oh, God.
Like, that's why they did it.
That's pretty funny.
And that whole tour was based on that. And I think they even met with Spinal Tap on that tour.
Oh, yeah? it's jokes.
Yeah. They had, like, a photo op with Spinal Tap. Another Steven Tyler quote that is kind of Spinal Tappy. It's a little druggy. It's just funny that I just kind of imagine a Derek Smalls saying it.
Well, Jerry Garcia said that we were the druggiest bunch of guys the Grateful Dead ever saw. They were worried about us, so that gives you an idea of how fucked up we were.
Yeah, Jerry Garcia thinks you're fucked up. You're pretty fucked.
So yeah, Jake, you go ahead now.
Okay, so the first one I had is, like, this kind of reminded me of the scene where Nigel and the bread.
Yeah,
where he wants the bread. Yeah.
He keeps folding and folding.
Basically, I heard that Van Halen would always have on their rider, which is the piece of paper that you give to, like, the venue to tell them what you want, like, backstage.
Sure. Yeah.
It always specifically said, like, oh, we want a bowl of M&Ms with all the brown M&Ms taken out.
Oh.
Which is, like, I assume really fucking annoying and just, like, you know, such a... Like, later, apparently, David Lee Roth from Van Halen claimed that the reason they did it was to make sure that they read the rider, but I don't know. To me, it just sounds like they were being annoying and, like, But yeah, it just seems like something Spinal Tap would do.
Even if that's true, that's like an annoying way to do that.
Yeah, exactly. Do you really have to, like, make them take it out? Like, it just seems like Nigel would be backstage and be like, you see, it's got brown M&Ms in it, and I don't like those ones.
I can imagine that.
And the second one is, this is apparently true. But I also want to mention that this was a variation of this showed up in Wayne's World 2, which is another great movie, where they talk about Ozzy wanting a brandy glass full of brown M&Ms before he goes on stage.
Very good.
Which is obviously a variant of that. And so the next one involves Alice Cooper.
Okay.
Which is, you know...
Yeah, he's very Spinal Tappy already.
He's very Spinal... Well, yeah, like, a lot of things involving snakes and stage props.
Right.
But, like, I just want to introduce this whole, like, what this whole bit is with just a quote by Alice Cooper.
Okay.
Or Vince Furnier, if you prefer. In 30 years... I've never had a snake defecate on stage, and this one decided that was gonna be the night.
All right, I like where this is going already.
Good start.
This is just sort of a stage disaster where apparently Alice Cooper was, like, doing a show, as he has done many, many hundreds of times, with snakes.
I witnessed one, not from the inside of a concert, but I sat outside of an Alice Cooper concert on a tall ship in Bay City, Michigan.
So basically what happened was this snake took a dump all over the stage, which is, like, you don't really think that, like, when you see a snake, you don't really think about the risk of it taking a shit on stage.
No, you don't think about that too often.
Like, so apparently the way he puts it, he says, "The audience was laughing at all the wrong times, so I knew that there was something wrong. I didn't realize it at first, and then all of a sudden I went, what's that? because it was a really horrific smell.
Oh God.
I'd say.
Wait, hold on. Just to the audience was laughing at all the wrong times implies that there were times in his show that they were supposed to be laughing.
I think that there's probably a time in an Alice Cooper show where you're supposed to laugh.
Yeah, I know, which is hilarious.
Yeah,
I know. To think of like a rock and roll concert where times where you're supposed to laugh.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So he said it left about 8 piles that if you saw it, you'd say a Doberman pincher or a Great Dane would have left a pile like that. The side of my stage clothes. So like it actually shat on him.
Oh, that's so bad.
But like, I don't know, if you've ever seen Alice Cooper, like this is not a small snake.
Right, yeah. This
giant chunking snake. So he said now the roadies, who are dressed as clowns, by the way, are on stage trying to clean up all this stuff, and it smells so bad and that all the clowns are throwing up. Now I have clowns throwing up on stage and a boa constrictor crap all over.
That's amazing.
Like, oh, that just sounds like the most disastrous show you could imagine.
Yeah, that's very Spinal Tap.
I believe that's more Spinal Tap than Spinal Tap could even achieve.
Yeah. Like, would you rather get, you know, stuck in a pod or have a boa constrictor shit on you?
Stuck in a pod any
tough
day of the
choice.
Week.
Yeah, I don't know.
I should add, there's also a lot of stories of Alice Cooper like accidentally leaving snakes in hotel rooms.
Okay, yeah.
And like they would like go inside the toilet room.
That's a bit unfortunate, like, that he mistreated all those snakes.
Yeah, I don't know.
Also, snakes don't like vibrations and stuff. I feel like it's not a great idea to have a snake at like the loudest possible event.
Right.
Like, maybe he had a snake professional on board and this.
I'm pretty sure he did. Like, he seems like, I don't know, he seems like he is very serious about his snakes.
Like, I guarantee later Alice Cooper did.
Yeah.
Had like a snake guy. I don't know about like early Alex Cooper, but I don't know.
Yeah,
who knows.
Yeah.
We'll look into it.
That's very funny.
Yeah,
that's good.
I've got a quick one here. I was kind of looking. I was thinking that the scene with Ian Faith, and he's talking about the cricket bat, and then there's the flashbacks of him smashing TVs with it. I was kind of curious about, you know, band managers that might have had that kind of reputation. So
does this involve Led Zeppelin?
It does involve Led Zeppelin.
Is this Peter Grant?
This is Peter Grant, the band manager for Led Zeppelin, who's over 6 feet, over 300 pounds, big dude.
Jesus
and
Christ.
And was notorious for not taking any shit from anyone, and especially shaking down people at Zeppelin shows who were trying to bootleg record or anything like that. And there's a quote here. When a bootlegger or unauthorized photographer was identified, it was the lucky infringing party who was let off with a severe verbal reprimand and confiscating of unauthorized t-shirts and film. So he was known for beating the shit out of them. And there's also an incident where him and his security team got in a fight with a promoter staff and ended up getting jailed.
Oh, jeez.
Holy shit.
Along with John Bonham, because John Bonham was like, I'll join the fight.
Right.
Yeah, of course, of course.
Anyway, and I was also looking, this is not as related, but I thought it was kind of interesting, at band managers. Are you familiar with Kit Lambert?
The name sounds really familiar.
Yeah.
So he was the band manager for The Who in their early days, including Tommy. But this is, I was reading
he basically like built the band. That's right.
So when he was younger, before he met The Who, he went on to an expedition in Brazil to try and map out the longest undescended river in the world, the Iriri. So he went on this expedition with his friend, and the expedition ended in disaster when his friend was abducted and killed in a ritual sacrifice by a cannibal tribe.
Oh, jeez.
What?
So I can imagine that being something that might happen in Spinal Tap. Also, that's very tragic.
I mean, it happened to one of their drummers.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like that's how they love a story. Yeah. I can see that being a story they tell in Spinal Tap.
Yeah, exactly.
It was extremely tragic.
So this is kind of a bigger one. So we're all familiar with Rob Reiner, director of the film.
Yes, we are.
But are you familiar indeed. With Rob Reiner?
Yeah, I'm not sure what you're getting at here.
What's the difference here?
So Rob Reiner, spelt R-O-B-B, Reiner, same
Rob.
Spelling, double B okay. Rob, is okay. one of the two co-founding members of the Canadian heavy metal band Anvil.
Oh, right, yeah.
Oh, right, sick. Yeah. That's right.
Right, so we can hold judgment till the end to decide what's going on here. But so the story of Anvil is Rob Reiner and his partner Stephen Lips Kudlow, Lips being his nickname, grew up in the Toronto area and formed a band when they were 14 together, called Gravestone, and went on to form Anvil. Anvil is known for their ridiculous imagery of album covers and song names such as Thumb Hang, based on the Spanish Inquisition, and Show Me Your Tits. and, you know, Anvil's flying, shooting bullets, etc.
Yeah.
But Anvil was pretty big at some point in the mid-80s, is when they formed in 1981, and that was their first album, and then they kind of toured for a bit. They kind of fell out of favor, and then they were kind of like lifers, right, doing their gigs and etc. And in the early mid-2000s, they were kind of touring in obscurity. And one of their former fans, let me get this right,
Martin Bergie?
Sasha Gervaisi, who was like a diehard fan of theirs in the 80s, caught up with them after he had become a director and screenwriter. And he decided that he wanted to film them and make a movie yeah. about their tour. So they were on a tour of Europe, which was just a calamity of, you know, playing for supposed to be a 10,000 seat arena that was guaranteed a crowd of 5,000, and 170 people showed up, and getting lost in Prague, missing their train, missing their flight, etc. And so that's all very Tap-like. And they get some solace in the end because, and I kid you not, they get big in Japan again.
So, like, because this happened after Spinal Tap.
This
are we
happened,
sure that...
So, okay. So,
yeah.
So, anyway, it's these two guys. They're touring in obscurity for a long time. A former fan of theirs catches yeah. back up with them, makes a movie about them, and yeah. then they get big in Japan. Also, yeah. This is kind of self-fulfilling prophecy. They were both produced by a studio in England that had amps that turned to 11, and they also had their own amps that turned to 11, and they pilgrimaged to Stonehenge. The list really goes on.
Yeah, it's but crazy.
My point being, so yeah, so they kind of became big after Spinal Tap came out.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
I mean,
they're the real life Spinal Tap, but are we sure that Spinal Tap aren't just time travelers from the future that saw the career arc of Anvil and was like, let's go back in time and make a movie about that before it happens?
No, I kind of suspect that they probably massaged several aspects of the Anvil film to be more like Spinal Tap because they thought it would be funny.
No, they did, and they self-admitted that.
Yeah.
But the parallels are very, very... They're really there.
Well, yeah, because they're on purpose.
Yeah.
No, but even just of their career of them like being together since they were 14 and you know, touring in obscurity and getting big in Japan.
But I mean, I feel like part of that was because Spinal Tap was like supposed to kind of represent like a lot of different rock and roll bands at the time. It was like, you know,
Like, it doesn't seem surprising to me that that would actually happen.
Yeah, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I suppose that's true.
Because the whole point was Spinal Tap was supposed to be believable as, like, a real band. Yes. Right? So yeah. It's like, you know.
But it's also...
It's not surprising that that actually happened to a real band.
But it is surprising that the guy's name is also Rob Reiner.
That is the most surprising part.
That is the most surprising.
It's
that
all
is like,
identical. Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's time travel. I don't know, Keaton, what do you think?
Time travel is not what I was expecting you to say. So that
I mean,
really
this
surprised
is the
me.
Truth.
Yeah, exactly. I thought it would be a welcome twist.
Yeah, Keaton, no, where are the aliens?
No, it's totally welcome.
Christopher Guest is a time traveling alien who stole Anvil's identity.
Interesting theory.
So is Rob Reiner and Rob Reiner the same person?
In the time
traveling.
Yeah,
maybe
he's
the time traveling alien. I don't know.
So did Rob Reiner travel to the past or did Rob Reiner travel to the future?
Oh god. Oh, I don't know. Anyway. So, anyway, that's the Anvil story, which they are legitimately the closest thing to a real-life Spinal Tap.
I actually haven't seen the film.
It's very funny. Anvil's you should watch it.
It's Anvil, the story of Anvil, right?
Anvil, exclamation mark, the story of Anvil, for anybody who hasn't seen it. Anyway, very funny.
Yeah, good movie.
There's another clip I had seen of Christopher Guest talking about some of the actual inspirations that he saw. That he had of Spinal Tap, and he tells this story of he was in LA waiting for a friend in the lobby of a hotel, and he sees this British band, and the manager is up at the check-in, and then suddenly he turns to the members, and it's 1974, and the manager's like, "Where's your bass?" Huh. And the bass player's like, I don't know. I think I might have left at the airport." It's like, You left your bass at the airport. And then it's like, I don't know, where's my bass? And then where's my bass? Where's the bass? I don't know, you tell me. It's like, I don't know, you tell me.
Right.
Apparently this went on for 15 minutes where they were just confused about the bass and then asking each other where the bass was.
He doesn't say who the band was, though.
No,
okay.
He provides some anonymity.
Right.
Bummer.
In terms of other connections, there's the obvious... Yoko Ono caricature.
Oh,
Janine.
Yeah.
But what I thought was pretty funny was she just... I love the scene where she's, like, just suggesting they become Kiss, and she starts handing them Zodiac sign, like, drawings that she's like, it's so easy. Anyway, so that's also a Kiss relation.
Hey, I mean, it worked for Kiss.
Yeah.
Passes him the bug one.
Oh, yeah. I wish I was this one.
Yeah,
or it was a crab, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He's just a goat with devil horns, right?
Yeah.
Anyway.
So, Keaton.
Yeah.
Do you have your truth?
Yeah, I got a couple here for you. So, I'll start off small and we'll work our way up to the bigger ones. The first small one. Brian Eno hypnotized Coldplay.
What? That doesn't surprise me.
Which sounds very Spinal Tap. I'm sure Brian Eno hypnotized Spinal Tap at one point.
Oh yeah.
But no, he didn't hypnotize them, but during the making of Zyloto or whatever, however you pronounce it, Brian Eno came in and was like, "Here, you guys have to try recording while you're under hypnosis." Like,
sounds like a very Brian Eno suggestion.
And they were like, "Yeah," and they were like, "Yeah, all right, Brian." So Brian brought a guy in who hypnotized them, and they recorded a little bit while "quote unquote" under hypnosis. And they were like, "Yeah, it didn't really do much for us, but we, you know, we're open to new experiences, I guess."
So did it? I assume it didn't make it to the album.
I don't know, it's unclear, but it may have. It's possible. Right. So next, I couldn't find any cases of any rock stars spontaneously combusting.
Unfortunate.
It is unfortunate.
Or
there are
fortunate.
Quite a few who have been electrocuted, if that's what you're getting at.
No, but one better... once in the Black Sabbath recording studio, guitar player Tony Iommi, doused drummer Bill Ward with alcohol, and lit him on fire.
What?
While in front of producer Martin Birch.
What the fuck was going on in there?
So,
That's ridiculous.
What is the context to this?
It was a quote-unquote prank that these guys often
it's an intense fucking prank.
Well, these guys like pranked each other all the time, apparently, but they often did this too, where they like performed this to like freak people out. So they'd done it before, but like normally the alcohol would just burn off.
So the guy was in on it.
Yeah.
The guy that was doused was in on it. It wasn't a prank on him.
No, I think this was a prank on Martin Birch.
A fucking shitty prank.
Yeah, exactly. I think they were trying to freak out Martin Birch.
Right.
Normally the alcohol just burns off and they have a laugh. But this time that he poured a bit too much, or I don't know what happened, but it soaked into Ward's clothes. And the fire like really caught on. So he was like genuinely on fire.
Jeez.
And he was like rolling around on the ground, like screaming on fire.
Did he sustain severe burns?
Well, Tony Iommi was pouring more alcohol onto him because he thought it would hurt him a bit. So he was just standing over him laughing, pouring more alcohol onto this friend who was like, while this other guy stood there horrified. An ambulance had to be called, but he was fine.
He wasn't horribly disfigured?
I think he got some burns, but nothing too horrible.
Right.
But they stopped doing pranks like that.
Yeah.
So no spontaneous combusting. And now finally, this one is, I couldn't help myself. This one, you'll see why this one's for me, but this one's also a bit for Felix too.
Okay.
So this is an interview with, Ace Frehley.
So it's not for me, basically.
No, this is not. You won't enjoy this at all.
All right, great. I'm looking forward to this.
It's an interview with Ace Frehley.
Oh, yes.
Well, that's a good start.
This is him. My dad was an electrical engineer. My brain is just attracted to that type of stuff. I also read a lot of books about Einstein. I'm fascinated by the speed of light and whether we can go beyond it. Some people believe that time travel is possible.
Oh, God.
I'm also completely intrigued by the idea that maybe human beings were spawned from aliens.
That's good. That's good. Okay.
That's good. Yeah. So that sounds like something that like Nigel Tufnell would say to me.
I don't know. We're bordering on Jose here.
Yeah, we are for sure. So then the interviewer asks him, "I'm gonna need you to elaborate. Do you mean like in Scientology? Are you talking about Xenu?" And then this is how Ace Frehley responds. Listen, Homo sapiens have been around for about 300,000 years, but in the last 5,000 years, our brain capacity has tripled, and there's no explanation for that biologically. The only logical explanation I can come up with is that we mated with aliens, and our DNA mixed with theirs and gave us that much more intelligence. How do you think the pyramids got built?
Wait, so he didn't deny being a Scientologist?
No, he didn't. He did not.
That's pretty good. But it's not just like the aliens gave us Scientologists. We specifically mated with them.
Yeah.
And I like, he ends that rant with, how do you think the pyramids got built?
How do you like being the pyramids?
It's like, I don't fucking know. It's like, it's the easiest way to stand up a structure.
There's actually I feel like a couple more stories about Ace Frehley just came to my mind, actually.
There's the one night
he showed up on Gene Simmons' doorstep in full Nazi SS attire.
Yeah, well,
And he just started doing Sieg Heil over and over again, just blasted out of his mind, and Gene was just like, go home, Ace. Yeah.
But I was thinking of, like, something slightly funnier. stories, like very Spinal Tap.
Well, apparently Ace Frehley was laughing hysterically the whole time during
this interview. This interview started with the guy saying, like, I expected to be talking about his new book that is coming out, but instead we talked about Nazis and aliens.
Jeez. So I was just thinking of, like, the story about him, like, not taking off his makeup, like, falling asleep in his makeup, and then, like, having, like, it react when his face and he got, like, a rash.
Yikes.
Oh, God. Yeah, that's because they were use cheap makeup, probably.
Yeah, I guess. But yeah, that just seems very Spinal Tappy.
So, do you want to hear the rest of this interview with Ace Frehley?
Yeah, okay. Is this just all about aliens?
Well, there's a few more back and forth left here.
All right.
So to answer the question, how do you think the pyramids got built? The interviewer responds, I don't know, Egyptian teamsters. And then Ace Frehley goes on, what about Chichen Itza and all that stuff? All the great civilizations from the past had one commonality, and that's pyramids.
Ah, yes.
And then the interviewer asks, how do you know that you personally have alien DNA? Is it just a hunch, or do you ever feel or think or behave in a way that suggests in an otherworldly bloodline?
That's an excellent lead-on.
What publication is this? the interview is interviewing for?
Let me find out.
Like, who is this interviewer?
No, it's a shitty interview. It's not a good interview.
Yeah.
A shitty website. Like, the interviewer has some really questionable... that's right. It's MTV News.
Okay.
It's an interview with MTV News.
Yeah, you know they just want the clickbait. They're just like, so tell me more.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, go on.
Dig your hole deeper.
So his response to how he knows that he has alien DNA is, well, let's just say that sometimes I feel a lot smarter than other people.
Oh God. I thought we all had alien DNA.
Smarter how? I never took a guitar lesson. I never took an art lesson. I just know how to do a lot of things, and nobody ever told me how to do it.
Uh-huh. Oh,
God. It kind of sounds like you're a moron there, Ace.
Yeah. I mean, Ace doesn't strike me as, like,
a scholarly fellow.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? He's smarter than other people.
He reads lots of... He's obsessed with Einstein.
Yeah.
And the speed of light.
I mean... He seems a bit thick to me, to be honest.
Yeah.
He comes across pretty thick.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, that's a great interview.
I assume it goes on.
Does it go on?
There's more, but we don't need to include the rest of it. You can go read it. You can search MTV News Ace Frehley interview. Aliens. It's in there. There's a lot of it. It's quite long, actually.
I wonder if he knows how that.
Maybe. They talk about Nazis, too.
They should get in touch.
Like.
Does he not have any explanation for, like, why the aliens are... So I assume that the aliens are supposed to be just humanoid, right? Like,
he doesn't say.
Right, but if some people are more alien than other people and all humans look the same, then surely they must look the same as humans.
I think he goes into more detail in his book.
Oh, okay, sick. Which one?
It's called...
Is it Into the Void?
No.
With Ace Frehley. That's not his book. That's the expose that his girlfriend wrote on him.
Gross.
Yeah, it's not good.
I don't want to hear anything about that.
Yeah.
It's called No Regrets.
Okay.
Oh, God. That's a loaded title.
Sounds like he should have regrets.
Yeah.
If I was Ace Frehley, I'd almost definitely have regrets, but I guess...
Yeah, like... Not cash in on that cow specifically the Nazi outfit thing.
Finally, to return to Spinal Tap, because it wouldn't be Crank It Commentaries if we didn't, let's really quickly talk about the lawsuit.
Okay, yeah.
So I didn't know there was a lawsuit.
There was a lawsuit. It happened quite a bit after the film.
Okay.
Yeah, very recently, actually.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to, like, read a few excerpts from the Wikipedia page because it's not long. It's just interesting, and I think we should include it.
Because it's a lawsuit and we can't resist that shit. We love copyright law.
It's interesting. It's very interesting.
Universal Pictures, come at me.
So on October 17th, 2016.
Okay, very recent.
Yeah. Harry Shearer filed a $125 million fraud and breach of contract lawsuit against both Studio Canal, the successor in interest to Embassy Pictures, and Vivendi, which owns the studio. Shearer claimed that he and the other co-stars of the film received only $179 for sales of merchandise and music over the prior three decades.
Yikes.
So that's pretty fucked up.
Yeah. That's pretty bad.
And like, obviously it's made much more than that. So in February 2017, Shearer's co-stars Christopher Guest and Michael McKean, as well as Rob Reiner, joined the lawsuit against Studio Canal and Vivendi, seeking $400 million in damages.
Right.
In the same month, Vivendi made an attempt to motion the court to dismiss the case. In September of 2017, a judge dismissed Shearer, Reiner, and McKean from the case. So essentially, it got kind of muddled. They almost lost it, but then they revised it and they brought Universal Music Group into the case, which really saved shit because I think they're a big company with big lawyers. Exactly.
Yeah.
So this really put shit back on track. And in August 2018, Judge Dolly G ruled that Guest, Reiner, McKean, and Shearer may pursue the fraud claim against Vivendi, which is the studio, owns the studio.
Yeah. So Vivendi's like also one of the world's largest media companies. Like, it's insane, like how much shit they own. So like, this is like a
pennies.
Huge
drops in the bucket.
Yeah, but also like, it's a lot of balls to come like just as them and sue Vivendi.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nice. Go for it.
Yeah. So the case related to sales of the soundtrack was settled out of court by November 2019.
Okay, got something.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Do we know how much, or is that kept secret?
No, that's usually not public.
Right.
So...
But presumably it was enough that, you know
enough that they sold.
They sold, right? Like,
nice, good for them. It's also kind of bullshit that they didn't get anything for that long, though.
Yeah, well, definitely.
Well, so... UMG retained distribution rights with the music, but eventually returning to Shearer, Guest, and McKean in the future. A settlement between Vivendi, Studio Canal, and the cast on the merchandising aspect was reached in September 2020, with final details to be resolved in the following months. So,
okay, so the full lawsuit is still yet to be resolved.
Yeah,
but
theoretically,
there's a
proto-agreement
in place that they're working together on it.
But okay. It looks like the music aspect has been resolved, which is good.
Right. Okay. So it looks like they got what they want.
Yeah, it looks like they were successful, which is awesome.
Mm. Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
$179.
Yeah, I know.
That's that's absurd. Well, I was looking at it.
Like, I don't know. Wait, does that include... Like, I wonder what that includes. Like, if they're just talking about, like, the original soundtrack album, or if that includes the stuff that they recorded afterwards as well.
Mm. Good question.
Because I'm wondering if... Because that wasn't... Like, they probably recorded that on their own, like, just through Universal Music, right? So, like, I don't know if Vivendi would have any stake in that. I'm not sure.
Yeah,
because,
I
don't know. My question is, like, obviously...
Maybe
Vivendi owns
the
rights to the film itself and probably all the music in the film too.
Maybe they got just some money from the trademarking.
Yeah, but I'm saying like I wonder who owns the because the writing credits I assume are still with.
Well, it would have to be,
yeah,
right?
So
yeah,
I don't know. I wonder who owns who how that was split up. But yeah, like I assume that they only got $179 of what they were supposed to get from Studio Canal or Vivendi.
Yeah, yeah.
Not necessarily that they only made $179 off all of the music ever, because then, like, I would question why they would go back and record later albums if they were only getting $179.
Yeah, from, yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah,
just for fun, I guess.
Yeah, but it, like, the amount that they were seeking implies that they were getting stiffed a lot out of a lot. But yeah, there you have it. That's like most of our details.
Nice.
Yeah.
So it's kind of time for us to close things out for the evening with our some of our final thoughts on the film. You want to start us off there, Felix, as our honored guest?
Sure, yeah. Well, I love this movie, honestly. It's one of the funnier movies I think I've ever seen, and I don't know. I love the soundtrack. I love a lot of the Spinal Tap songs. I do own the soundtrack record, so
yeah,
I think it's all good fun. And I hadn't watched it enough times, so it was really fun to go back and watch it for the podcast. And you know, I hope with you two guys being the creative geniuses of this podcast, you know, you guys are kind of like fire and ice, and I hope I was able to, you know, kind of bridge that, like lukewarm water.
Yeah, always.
It's like fire and ice, basically. You see, and I feel my role is to be kind of in the middle of that, kind of like lukewarm water.
Jake, what do you think?
I mean, I don't know. Obviously, it's such a classic film, and I just really want to stress that, like, the reason I think it was so effective and so funny is because of how on the nose it was.
Yeah, for sure. It's like, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
It's pretty bold in a way, too. Like,
yeah.
It's a lot of, like, it's a very critical film. You know?
Yeah, definitely. Like, it's cutting.
Yeah, exactly.
Ripping a bunch of people and a whole industry totally, like...
Yeah, no.
Yeah, well, I mean, they kind of deserve it, to be honest.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, totally. Totally deserve it, but yeah, still. Especially, like, an industry that's, like, kind of parallel to their industry. Like, it's not...
Yeah. I mean, clearly they knew a lot of, like, people in it, because, like, they had, like, some proper, like, musicians show up in their film.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So I thought that, like, it... As I mentioned earlier, it, like, the fact that the music was good is so important for making it, like, last so long. But also, something that most people mention when they watch this movie is, like, every time you rewatch it, there's, like, kind of a new thing you notice.
Mm.
So that's kind of where its rewatchability comes from. So it's kind of one of those cult movies.
Yeah, definitely. I could rewatch this movie so many times.
Yeah, I feel like I caught a lot more from it than I did, any other time. Like, you know, it's good.
Like, it's fun also because, like, I watched it probably dozens of times when I was, like, a kid, and probably fewer times since I've been an adult. So watching it as an adult, I mean, I'm catching even more and more things. So it's like there's still fucking great shit in there. So... Everybody who hasn't seen it in a while, I encourage you to go watch it right now. Or,
for sure.
Honestly, I encourage you to watch the movies that we're talking about before we talk about it, because we ruin everything about it. It's probably more fun if you know what talking about. But
yeah, that's just... I mean, obviously some people are going to listen to this without having seen the movie, but that's just the way it goes. But
yeah. So if you've gotten to this point and you haven't seen the movie and you ruined it for yourself...
I don't think we really ruined it, because I don't think... like. I don't think there's really anything to ruin in the movie.
No,
like, there's no plot details that you really care about. Like,
point being, go get a neuralize yourself.
Yeah,
and then go, but tell yourself to go watch the movie and then come back and listen to the podcast again. Make sure that's in the statement. We want.
Yes.
You got to make sure you can do that.
Yeah.
Yes. And finally, very finally, Felix, as our honored guest, would you like to plug anybody, anything, any place? To our esteemed, glorious audience, who we love.
We love all of you.
I don't know that I really have anything to plug. Local businesses. Yes. Shop local.
Support local
in Toronto, Ontario. Well, or wherever you are.
Wherever you are.
Wherever you are.
Amazon's making too much money.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, don't shop with Amazon.
If you can avoid it.
Yeah.
I understand that it's convenient and for some things you don't have any options, but if you,
like, don't shop with Amazon until they give us some affiliate links.
Do what you gotta do if you gotta do it. There's never any shame if you gotta do what you gotta do, but if you can,
if you can do, shop local.
Anyway, we've gotten really off topic here. We're talking about Spinal Tap.
What's gonna play us out?
I think I got one for her.
Something sick.
Yeah, okay. Ready?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, well, actually, yeah, I guess we'll see you next time.
Next week. Right.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Thanks for being on the show.
Until next time. I probably won't be here next week. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'll be here whenever.
I don't think you'll be here next week, but we'll see.
You'll be out here for a seventh time next time.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll be here again.
Yeah.
All right. Peace, guys.
This ain't a place to be a man. I ain't got no future, I ain't got no past, and I don't think I ever can. The floor is filthy, the walls are thin, the wind is howling in my face. The rats are beating, I'm losing ground, can't see the jungle in the race. Yeah. Who? The food's too hot. The kitchen stinks of all the snails.